was like 1,000 years ago. I fought my way out of that cave, became Iron Man. Realized I loved you. I know I said no more surprises, but I was really hoping to pull off one last one.
The world has changed. None of us can go back. All we can do is our best. And sometimes the best that we can do is to start over.
I saw all these people die. I keep telling everybody they should move on. Some do. But not us.
Even if there's a small chance, we owe this to everyone who's not in this room to try.
We will. Whatever it takes. Whatever it takes.
Whatever it takes.
Whatever it takes.
I like this one.
Hey, 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 internet, what it do, where you be, who you are, who you see. This is us, Pop Culture Parenting. I am one of your hosts, Mark, but my friends call me Clyde Jones.
And I am Niels R.Y., a.k.a. The Silver Surfer. Where you at, though?
Woo! Where you at? And we are here in our new domicile, the Bat Cave, a.k.a. Nels' basement, man cave, nursery.
The Rec Room.
The Rec Room. The
Rock. I'm going to, you know, at some point, you'll probably know when this podcast was actually recorded because I'm going to put some Instagram pictures and stuff. Mm. And so you'll see clips of the now slowly constructed Rec Room.
Yeah.
But you got to say it like Sean Connery.
The Rec Room. Let's get to it. This is Pop Culture Parenting, the podcast where we look back at the media, pop culture, you know, the stuff that we consumed as young men and helped us shape ourselves and grow up. And we just look back on it. And now that we are parents, how we would introduce our kids to the media we watched and consumed as kids in the pop culture, and kind of contrasted with our views today and now that we're parents, all that good stuff. So if you're part of the show, you've been here before, you know that's what we do. But today is a very special day, and Nels, tell the people why today's so special.
Today is special, and it's going to be a Herculean effort for us to do this. We are going to react to Avengers Endgame. And so, like, this is not going to be a typical episode. And it's not going to be a typical review because we're not just, you know, talking about how dope this movie was. We're talking about the fact that this is the culmination of over 10 years.
11.
Over 11 years. Yeah. 11 years. And how many movies? 18, 17 movies? I think Avengers Endgame.
When it's all said and done with Spider-Man, isn't it like 20 something?
It's a lot of movies.
A lot of movies.
So we're going to be talking about the fact that Kevin Feige, all these amazing directors, writers, and actors were able to land. Yeah. Like, I'm talking like 1996 Olympics USA messing up your ankle landing.
Yes, yes.
And winning the gold medal for the country landing.
She hurt herself. herself on the first vault. Probably the last thing she should have done was vault again, but she did, and now she is in a lot of pain.
The amazing thing about it, though, John, she raised her hands overhead. Her head, she finished the vault.
Standing on one leg. We have got to find out if she's a 9.712. She has done it. Carrie Strong has won the gold medal for the United States team.
Yes, we're talking like Michael Jordan jumping from the free throw line, landing like straight tens across the board landing. So that's what the episode we're going to talk about. So obviously, if you have not seen Avengers Endgame, all three of y'all, because it made all the money, I would say, you know what? Sit back and listen to this episode. Enjoy the spoilers because... this is gonna be a whole bunch of spoilers.
There's gonna be spoilers. This is your final warning. Don't I don't want no emails. You spoiled. It's been 20 years in the 10 years in the making.
10 years in 19, it felt 20, like 20 years.
It though. Felt like 20 years. So this is your warning. I don't know why you're here if you haven't seen Endgame. There we go. But so Nels, why don't you start us off?
So I got some notes from folks. I'll just do some quick notes because this episode is all about Avengers Endgame.
Yeah.
So there's two things that we've heard from the pop cult. One is that they love hearing stories about like what we have been doing with our kids, mm-hmm. like activities and stuff. So they love to hear maybe in the beginning of the episode, what's going on with Kosi? What's going on with Ian, our children?
Okay.
What are we up to? What fun things are we doing with them? What are some things that we're showing them? Just to kind of give those parents out there some advice on like, you know, these are some fun, exciting, entertaining things that we are showing our children.
Okay.
So we will absolutely, we hear that and we'd love to share. I will say really quickly, my son watches Super Y. It is a show on PBS. It is a show all about reading, but it is with the main character being a superhero, and he's a person of color. His name is Wyatt. It's kind of a lame name, but anyways, Wyatt is Super Y, and so they fly around, explore books, and it's in the theme of superheroes. So it has my son's full attention, and like he reads the words, he says book, does the dances when they do the dances. So yeah, that's something that young Ian loves, Super Y.
I'm gonna check that out for Kosi. I haven't even heard of that. She's always been into Elmo, Sesame Street. That's
the Six Gods.
Six God in
the house. Six God of children.
You know, she loves Sesame Street. She started getting into something called Puppy Dog Pals because she loves dogs. Comes on the Disney Channel. It's these two really disturbing looking big eyed dogs, and they just get into
mischief
with other little dogs. I mean, it's harmless. It's cute. It I wish it was a little bit more educational. Like at least Sesame Street, she's like they're counting their letters. Yeah. Puppy Dog Pals is pretty much fun, but she loves dogs, and she loves to read. She loves books. Well, she can't read, but she loves to be read to. She loves books.
Don't limit your child. She might be able to read. Well, you just don't understand what she's saying.
Yeah. But I'm gonna assume she can't read for right now. But no, she like every she grabs book, and now she's like read book.
Oh,
and
she says read book.
She's like read book.
That's slightly more advanced than my child.
Well, no. So apparently,
I joke.
No, apparently girls develop quick.
Yes.
You know, so...
And Kosi's Nigerian, too, so she's like Nigerian, super advanced.
She has no choice but to develop quick and become a doctor or a
lawyer. She's going to get a law degree at 5 years old.
But I just been reading to her classics that I loved when I was a kid. So, like, One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish.
Yeah.
Which, when I look back, is... a really long book.
Yeah, bro.
I think it's like 30 pages.
Bruh. Dr. Seuss has books like the pages on pages.
Yeah.
The shortest stories are like 15 pages.
I thought this book was like 10 to... Nah, bro. So... and then like Green Eggs and Ham, another book that I didn't realize was as long as it was. But just the classics that I liked when I was a kid. She's into Clifford now. So we're...
Oh,
yeah, got into Clifford. Dope. So, you know, that's what we're just reading. We try to limit her screen time, if possible. The other day, her and I watched Secret Life of Pets, because of course there's doggies in it. Dogs, so she was just like, doggy, you know. So anything with a talking dog in it, she's about that life.
That is what's up. That is what's up. So the other thing that we've heard from the pop call is they love hearings. So not only do they like to hear things that we are doing with our kids, they like to hear, they love hearing stories from our childhood. Specifically, anytime I bring up my mom's accent. I promise y'all this, you will almost hear my mom's accent in every episode that we do, because if it comes to my childhood, I have a West African mother. She was strongly influential in what I was allowed and not allowed to do, including reading comic books. So the fact that, I mean, we're going to talk a little bit about the history of Marvel, and she's just like, oh, you are not allowed to read anyone but Spider-Man. I do not trust
who. Wait, why Spider-Man though?
She, because she saw an episode of the Fox Spider-Man show, and she really liked
and it. That sold her.
And that sold her. She did not like X-Men.
She's like, Peter Parker, I can get behind.
She's like, oh, he seems like a wholesome boy. Wholesome young man.
Probably Aunt May.
Aunt May is exactly why. Mike, you are a genius.
It was Aunt May.
She's like, oh, I like that. That is his influence. Okay.
What a good boy.
Gracious, Peter, you could have been hurt. If I'm to sleep peacefully at night when you're living on your own, you must promise to stop taking all these risks.
X-Men, she wasn't feeling the X-Men. She wasn't feeling a lot of those shows. But yeah, she loves Peter Parker. The show, she was cool with it. So yeah.
That is funny, man.
Only comic she was letting me buy from Marvel anyway.
That's funny. That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
Cool.
So we are going to jump into the episode. Excited to talk to y'all today about Avengers Endgame. And to kind of set the table, I'm going to do my typical historian job and talk a little bit, not just about like the setup of Avengers Endgame, but the setup of the MCU in general. So Mark, I'm going to jump in and talk about the history of where Marvel was before the MCU started and how we got the MCU. Feel free to jump in.
I will.
When necessary. So I do think this is common knowledge for nerds. But some of y'all may just forget some of the reasons things were the way they are. And I think for folks who just jumped into MCU for Black Panther, which good reason. I ain't mad at you. Yeah. I got a Black Panther poster on my wall right now. You may not know why things are the way they are. Like, why haven't we seen Storm yet? Like, her and T'Challa have been knowing each other since they were kids. Why isn't Storm in here? I'm gonna break it down for y'all. So, in the early 90s, 1995, 1996, Marvel files for bankruptcy.
You're broke, nigga. You're broke.
Chapter 11, I believe, bankruptcy. And the reason why is because there was a big boom of comics in the early 90s. Comic books got a lot of attention for two things, and they're both Superman related.
Can I guess one?
Yes.
Was it the death of Superman?
Absolutely, okay. Mark. The death of, like, if in comic book lore, one of the biggest things, and this was the reason I actually started reading comic books in the first place, was the death of Superman. It was one of the best-selling comic books in the early 90s. It was the, like, news channel started to pay attention to comic books because it was, like, the biggest story.
I remember seeing it on the news. And I wasn't into comics. The most I knew about Superman was even out the animated series, the Bruce Timm. Of course I knew who Superman was, but I remember seeing on TV, like, Superman dies. And I was like, and as a child, Superman
is Sparky? Yeah, so that's what got my attention. I was like, Superman's dying, and, like, the news, everybody was covering Superman's dying, so, like, everybody started paying more attention to comic books in general.
Just real quick, even back then, where we are with comics, that just shows how powerful these characters are in our culture, not even pop culture, that the news, this is before internet, the news was like, yo, they killed Superman in the comics. And that was back when, if you read comics, like, you're a nerd. Like, and it wasn't cool to be a nerd. It's like, you're a nerd, but they still covered it.
That so was, like, Superman had existed for 60 years at that point.
Dang.
60 years, and he was, like, primetime news.
Mm.
So, that was number one. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing, And this was what really start having people like running to comic book stores, and the reason that local comic book stores exist, or like were like still in existence. I'm gonna give like a few second pause, and because I want to know how nerdy y'all really are. If you got it, I want you to send a message to Pop Culture Parenting, and I'll be like yes. So I'll pause, press pause, send a message. We'll wait 3 seconds. All right. If you guess that the reason the comic books like skyrocketed in sales was because of the very first number one action comic, the first sign of a superhero, Superman's first appearance in the world, sold in an auction in like, I want to say 1994 for $1 million. It's probably worth way more than that now.
Oh yeah.
But the very first superhero comic book, Action Comics number one, sold for $1 million in an auction.
That's the iconic, him holding that green car.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. And so when that sold for $1 million, investors were like, yo, y'all need to find the next comic that is gonna be worth this much money. You gotta buy all the comics and collect them so you can cash out later on, like a baseball card.
Yeah.
So people were starting to buy comic books like baseball cards. And it wasn't going to last. So Marvel, DC, all these places skyrocketed in profit. Mm-hmm. And so they were just starting to do this, that, and the third. And so I'm going in kind of long. I'll sum it up real quick. The bubble bursted. And in like 96, 97, or like 95, people just stopped buying comic books the way they did.
Because they kind of oversaturated the market.
The market and raised up the prices to meet the demand. It was like supply versus demand. So they had to raise up the prices. And when they raised up the prices, they were really taxing the true comic book nerds, the true fans. And the fans were like, nope, can't do it.
So the true fans that were been there from day one are like, all right, we're done. Y'all, this is just to get the newbies in who are willing to pay this money.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And the newbies were only there to try to catch the next thing. And if they only sold like maybe 1,000 action comics, but they're selling 1 million of Batman number 25, you're not gonna make no money off of it.
Yeah.
As soon as you buy it, it's worthless. Worth pennies now. Yeah. So they were like, okay, well, I ain't gonna make no money off of this. I'm done. I'll move on to something else. And so they filed for bankruptcy. One of the things that they did in order to get out of bankruptcy was to sell their rights to film producers. They weren't making movies. They weren't making TV shows like that. So they were just like, okay, they don't have a studio. All they do is make comic books and do printing. So they're like, okay, who can we sell this to? Sell that to. Eventually, the folks, like around this time, there was really close to the 2000s, there was really three entities that owned pretty much all the rights to all the characters. Universal, Sony, eventually it became Sony, and Fox. They owned all the big wig characters in Marvel.
So,
it
was a dark time.
So, and at that point, Marvel was not successful with like in the movies department. They had just started to, Saturday morning cartoons, they had just started to be really good in the cartoon place, but not in the movie place. And then these movies came out in the late 90s that changed everything. Men in Black, Blade, X-Men, and Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
So Men in Black is a Marvel comic book. Y'all probably didn't know that, but it is.
I didn't know it was a Marvel. I knew it was a comic. I didn't know it was a Marvel, though.
It was eventually owned by Marvel.
Okay.
And Blade and X-Men. So, like, when those three came out, Marvel didn't make that much money, but they made money off of it.
They made enough to be like, there's something here.
Enough to get out of bankruptcy.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Spider-Man came out. And Spider-Man was huge.
At the time, the biggest movie in the world.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And they didn't get a lot from it. And so their investors were like, look, y'all need to figure out a way to, look, y'all's properties are making money. Y'all need to get into the movie business.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're like, bet, we are going to start a studio, and we are going to do what we can to make movies off of our property. Here's the problem. Your big wig characters. If you know Marvel, and the comic books that were selling at this time, there were only like three, four, things that were selling off the bookshelf that were actually making a profit for Marvel. It was Spider-Man, anything X-related.
Yeah.
Like, there's like four or five X-Men and Wolverine books. And then here and there, you get some Avengers stuff. Avengers was like the lowest of all the things that they were
paying attention to. Just to chime in, I remember growing up, when I heard about the Avengers, for me, that was like, that's like really like nerd. Like, you, if you were a comic book nerd, you mess with the Avengers. Like, it just, and even at the time, it seemed dorky. Like, what, Thor? Iron Man? Mm-hmm. They're a team? They're like, a team, you know, yeah. Like, that sounds really dumb.
For them to be the, they were not the, it wasn't a contest on which team was better, Justice League or the Avengers.
Oh, yeah.
Justice League had your all-star A-team folks going after it. Avengers was like, we can't do it by ourselves. We need to team up.
Yeah.
That's how it was, like, when you read an Avengers comic book, or at least how the story was. Because if Spider-Man and Wolverine weren't on a team, which they eventually were here and there, it's not a comic book you're going to read. Like,
no.
None of those characters at the time, except for sometimes Thor, could hold their own book well.
Yeah.
There is two things that happened in the late 90s, early 2000s, that made Marvel be like, yo, we can only buy one property, let's get it back. Two stories. Civil War and The Ultimates. Civil War, y'all probably know what Civil War is because there was a Marvel movie.
Loosely based off the comic, but...
Loosely, yeah. Civil War was one of the best limited stories to come out of Marvel ever.
Yeah.
It's an amazing
story. It's pretty great. If you're not even into comics, I recommend it. It's a
fantastic story. Mark Millar is an amazing writer.
Yeah.
Anything he makes is good. And then the other one's The Ultimate. So if y'all listen to our Spider-Verse episode, you'll know about The Ultimate Universe. The Ultimates was the name of the Avengers team in The Ultimate Universe, which had, you can guess it, Captain America, Iron Man, and Thor as some of their chief characters. And so with the success of those stories, Marvel was like, look, we got some money from the success of these movies. There's only one property we can get. We're going to get all of our Avengers back. And so they got the money to get Avengers. And so when you buy the property Avengers, anyone who has ever been an Avenger, you have the rights and properties to. Except for those who are owned, like, they didn't have the rights to anything mutant related because of the Fox deal. They didn't have anything Spider-Man related, including the villains, because of the Sony deal. And they couldn't make a standalone Hulk movie because of Universal. But besides that, everything Avengers related, they have the rights to.
Yeah. And if I could chime in real quick, it's funny when you look back on it, them selling everything kind of saved them because it got the buzz going and it was probably hell to get everything back. But it inadvertently, that's what saved them, was like selling all their properties and seeing the popularity and coming back and regrouping. And everyone came home. they all came home.
And so, like, we're taking some time to paint the picture, because when we're going into the 2000s, closer to like 2006, 2007, when it's time for them to be like, what is the character? What is the movie we're going to start off? How are we going to start our entire staple of the Marvel Studios on? And they hired Kevin Feige, who was a producer on like all these movies that we had just been talking about. And they decided to do two things. One, start with Iron Man, which, if anyone asked you, was a dumb decision.
Yeah.
And two, hire Robert Downey Jr., a washed up actor, to play Iron Man, which, if you ask anybody at the time, would have been a dumb decision, except for maybe us, because we were like, he's the perfect Tony Stark. Off top. And so that's where we are. So that is the picture of where we were when we started the MCU.
And you and I talk about this a lot, and our kids won't get it. Like, when you talk Marvel, who cared about Tony Stark? He was some dude in a robot outfit.
Yeah.
And he wasn't even a robot. So in my book, he wasn't even cool.
as one who loves what you love.
You know, yes. So he wasn't even cool. And now it's amazing, because not only is Iron Man kind of the face of Marvel, but Robert Downey Jr., all the interpretations of Iron Man are based off of him now.
Pretty much.
It's you watch any type of cartoon, comic book, it's okay, insert Robert Downey Jr. in this. There's your
keep it going.
Mr. Stark, you've been called the Da Vinci of our time. What do you say to that?
Absolutely ridiculous. I don't paint.
What do you say to your other nickname, the Merchant of Death?
That's not Ben.
They say the best weapon is one you never have to fire. I prefer the weapon you only need to fire once. That's how Dad did it. That's how America does it. And it's worked out pretty well so far. To peace.
Is it cool if I take a picture with you?
Yes, it's very cool. I don't want to see this on your MySpace page. Please, no gang signs. No, throw it up, I'm kidding.
You have till tomorrow to assemble my missile.
I should be dead already.
Unless it was for a reason.
I just finally know what I have to do.
That doesn't look like a missile.
What are you building, Stark?
I'm working on something big.
To start with Iron Man, who cared about Iron Man? And when that movie came out, I kind of went to go see it just to go see it. The trailer looked cool, and I was like, okay. And that was it. And
I was scared. I was like, I really want this movie to be good. Because I was an Iron Man fan. In no way, shape, or form, like, a huge Iron Man fan. If you were to ask me to name 10 comic book characters, he wouldn't have made it. But I was like, I love the cartoon. That was like my favorite cartoon, one of my favorite cartoons. And I was a Robert Downey Jr. fan. So I was like, man, this, like, I want it to be good because I want both of them to do well. I want Tony Stark and I want Robert Downey Jr. to do well. Got my wish. So we just talked about where they were. Obviously, the bet worked out. They were really successful. And now we're going to talk about how they pulled off this movie.
Yeah.
May I please start?
Go ahead.
Just come from the comic book nerd perspective.
Go ahead.
And I'd love to hear your thoughts. Like, I gotta catch my breath, y'all. I have to say this. If you are going to tell anything Infinity related, if you're gonna talk about the Infinity Stones, there's certain things that you have to do. And like, if I was Kevin Feige and they're like, okay, you have to tell a story about Thanos and Thanos versus the Avengers, and it's all Infinity Stones related, Infinity Gems related, how are you going to do it? I was like, okay, cool. Well, I need all of these characters that we don't have the rights to. We got to figure out how to get them because I can't tell the stories without them. I say all that to say, they were able to tell an Infinity story without mentioning Mistress Death, without mentioning Galactus, without mentioning Silver Surfer, and the biggest one of all, the hero of the Infinity Gem story, Adam Warlock, did not even make an appearance, not even a name mention in either of the movies. He wasn't in Infinity War and he wasn't in Endgame. And both these movies were amazing. Bruh, it's like the creative balls that it takes to do this. Like, it's like making a Three Little Bears movies without the Woodhouse and without the big bad wolf.
And you're gonna see what happens. Well,
and they're like, figure it out.
So, I think that's why this whole thing worked, because Hollywood's a copycat industry. So now everyone's planning their universe. We don't, like, people forget, like, this wasn't planned from the beginning. This wasn't like, all right, Iron Man 1 and then Infinity War. They're like, let's see what happens. And I personally think why this series works so well, it happened organically. it eventually we got to a point where like, okay, we're planning movies, but this kind of like, you know, that first Iron Man movie could have been a standalone, and that Nick Fury teaser at the end could have just been that, just been like, hey, yep, Nick Fury, and then, which I will say to this day, that's probably the best after credit scene in the MCU.
It has a soft spot in our hearts because
I can't think of a better one. I really can't.
I'm not gonna say there's a better one. I'm just gonna say like it was magical.
Yeah.
And it's kind of hard to like to do magic like that again.
Because I can only imagine how, because like you way more into comics than me, and I knew who Nick Fury was, and I even kind of, I was like, oh, Nick Fury's black, and I was like, oh snap, and I can only imagine like you like, what the hell is going
on? That's exactly, I was like, what? Yes. Because it's like one Nick Fury, you know who Nick Fury is. But like, they got Sam Jackson.
Yeah. Bro.
Like, that is Nick Fury. Like, the ultimate character of Nick Fury was based off of Sam Jackson. And they got the brother to say yes to it. To say yes to being in a superhero movie,
and then
one that you didn't even know was gonna be good,
and just the confidence to like, let me talk to you about the Avengers initiative, and that like people have heard that name, like, what are they really? And then I remember when Iron Man came out, me and a good friend of ours, we're just like, how are they gonna do Thor? It's gonna be so dorky. Like, how are they gonna do Hulk? How are they gonna do this? How are they gonna, you know? And so it just got the balls moving. And but it was just so organic, man, and just the patience that is so rare, especially nowadays in Hollywood, to let these characters breathe. And this is why DC fanboys, no, I'll say DCEU fanboys, hate me, whatever, the DCEU is a freaking mess because it's just a cash grab. Like, there's no buildup. Like, we don't care about Justice League because we don't know these characters. Mm-hmm. There was a Wonder Woman movie, and you had a terrible Batman v Superman movie, and an okay Superman movie.
I wanted
movie.
That movie to be so good.
Who didn't want that movie? And I said this before, and I'll say it again. This is why, if you're a DCEU fan, you should be pissed. You live in a world where most people would watch a movie about Ant-Man and Aquaman than watch a movie about Batman versus Superman. That is our existence. And just take the time to think about, if you told that to 1999 Nels, 2004 Nels, you'd probably shoot me.
Yeah, I would try to physically harm you, absolutely. I would try to choke the life out of you.
And don't
that's my childhood.
Nels,
die slowly.
I can't breathe, I can't. And no diss to those movies, because they're entertaining in their own right, you know, and I got a chance to watch Aquaman. It's a fun movie. I think it's dumb. But it's a
dumb fun.
It's dumb fun.
That's why you hired Jason Momoa.
Yeah, and he's a great choice for Aquaman. I haven't seen
that movie yet.
It's fun. It's a lot of fun.
I haven't seen Shazam either.
I haven't seen Shazam.
My feelings are hurt from Justice League. I haven't gone back.
But we want to have fun, and it's not a cash grab, and they took the time. So you had Iron Man, then you did the Incredible Hulk, and then, you know, Captain America, Thor. Then we had the Avengers, and just to get Josh Whedon at the time, it's like Marvel cared.
I'll say this. This is something you've mentioned to me for years, and it still holds true. You always say, like, just make a good movie.
Yeah.
Like, if you just focus on making a good movie, like, that's what we want. That's what we're here for. And I think the beautiful thing with Marvel is, like, number one is like they want to make a good movie, and everything else is number two.
Yeah,
it's like, let's make a good movie for our fans, and we will figure everything else out. And it worked. It's
the writer, I forget his name. It's something Carlisle. He wrote Sinister. He's the writer for Doctor Strange, and he was on a podcast that I used to listen to back in the day before he got picked up. And so he came back to his old podcast, and they were talking about the Marvel writing room, and he said, he's like, it's pretty amazing because they want to make everything dope. So he says the way the Marvel writing room works is like, oh, and Doctor Strange does this, and this happens, and this happens. And you bring it to like Kevin Feige or whoever, and they read it, and they go, okay, that's cool. Now make it cooler. And they give it back to you. And I'm like, what a great, like, place to work and, and respect these characters. Not like, oh, you know what's in right now? Flossing. And he needs to do the Dougie. Or we need to put in a Snapchat reference.
Why are you coming hard at Shazam right
now? No. Because that can work. I feel triggered. No. Because that can work if it adds to your story. But, like, I think there's just such a respect for the characters in Marvel. And at the end of the day, it's like, let's make a dope movie and the rest will follow.
Yeah.
And they've done that with all their characters. There's been some misses along the way. Like, Iron Man 2 was kind of like a studio interfering kind of cash grab kind of thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because even Jon Favreau said that, like, Marvel kind of, like, interfered. And this was before the Disney buyout, too. Yeah, you got to think about that. Yeah, yeah. So there's, like, you know, because Iron Man 2 just doesn't play as well as the first one.
No, it doesn't.
And then the first Thor, the first two Thor movies, they really didn't know what to do with that guy.
Let's keep it 100. I don't think anyone knew what to do with Thor.
Yeah.
Until what's his name?
Tatuiki.
The brother deserves for his name to be known because he figured out, was like, you got Chris Hemsworth. We need to just make a movie about Chris Hemsworth and his amazing comedic timing.
Yes.
And the fact that, like, he just so happens to be playing a character named Thor. Like, genius.
And
he
figured
it out. Yeah.
It worked. But yeah, this thing is so organic.
And Loki chewing up scenery.
Yeah.
That's a perfect combination.
Brother.
Chris Hemsworth being funny and charismatic and Loki chewing up scenery.
And
equals good movie.
And I think once we got... Because even Ultron, I feel like that's... Maybe it's not the studio's fault, but that movie didn't work as well as Avengers. But I like Ultron.
I don't want to interrupt you. Ultron is very polarizing.
Yeah.
I don't like Age of Ultron. Like, I put it as one of the bottom. I talked to our Fry brothers about this, and that's all of them. That's, like, one of their number ones. Like, they're like, that is one of the best movies that has so many dope moments.
I wouldn't go that far.
Neither would I.
I wouldn't go that far.
They're tripping.
But
that's the movie they love.
Endgame. We'll kind of go into Endgame. Endgame gives you one moment. If you watch Ultron, it makes Endgame that much better. The Captain America nudging.
Yes.
Thor's hammer. That's five. And that's what I'm saying about this organic. Willing to take your time and let things breathe. That is a 5-second scene in Ultron. Maybe one of the, like, worst Marvel movies in the MCU. But it makes for such an amazing moment in Endgame.
So I think that's a great transition to the next topic I wanted to talk about, which is how they reward the fans. Like, I really think... And I wonder how folks jumping into the MCU feel about Endgame, because... To me, and I'm almost positive any review that you'll hear, this is really a love letter to the fans.
It is.
And they reward those fans who've been with them since 2008 in every single way, shape, or form. So I'll name a few, and then, like, I'd love for you to react to it. One, you were just talking about Thor. When they were talking about the mission to, like, do the timescape.
Time heist,
thank you. Thor is just sitting there and, like, just, like, begrudgingly explaining the Dark World, which is the worst MCU movie. And he's just like, they spent like 5 good minutes on Thor describing the worst movie. And I feel like they knew what they were doing. They're like, yeah, we're gonna talk about the Dark World.
Dark World. Like, oh, Jane and, but you know what? I rewatched some of Dark World after Endgame, and it doesn't make it better, but it kind of, like, justifies it.
It's not a bad movie.
It's not bad.
It's not a bad movie. It's just not one of the best MCU movies.
Yeah.
They're, like, you have to grade on a scale with these movies. Like, the worst MCU movie would be one of the best DC movies.
And that's what another mutual friend of ours, who's a DC fanboy, DCEU fanboy, and we get into it all the time. And I'm like, dog, Marvel has been granted my benefit of the doubt at this point. When your worst movies are Iron Man 2, Thor the Dark World, and, like, Age of Ultron, what are those, like C pluses at the worst?
Yeah, at least.
You know, like you're granted a lot of leeway. At the end of the day, they're still solid movies.
And the funny thing is, the movies that you'll say are the worst movies is somebody's favorite.
Yeah, yeah.
It's somebody's favorite. I know four people who Age of Ultron is in their top three. Mm. Not even top five, their top three. I like Incredible Hulk, and some people will put that at the bottom, and I'm like, that's a really good movie.
I liked it too. I liked it a lot too.
It's debatable. So that was one. This one I've been saving for the podcast. I haven't tweeted, I haven't done anything because I haven't seen anybody mention it. It's a beautiful thing. So when Black Panther comes back and Clint Hawkeye comes out and he has the Infinity Gauntlet, and Black Panther looks at him and he's like, Clint, give me the gauntlet, or give it to me. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, some folks are probably thinking, oh, this is because Black Panther is one of the folks who's like historically known to have the Infinity Gauntlet. Nah, that's not what I'm talking about. The reason that's so dope is if you go back to Civil War and Clint and Black Panther face off right before they tussle, Clint's like, hi, I'm Clint. Like, I don't think we've met. He's like, hi, I'm Clint. Black Panther's like, I don't care.
I don't care.
And so you fast forward to now. He's like, Clint. He acknowledges his name. Yeah. He's like, Clint, give it to me. Like, bruh.
Yeah.
That is so...
That
is so subtle.
I never thought about that. Because you know what? I was like, how does he know his name? I was like, how does...
Because he introduced himself. He's like, hi, I'm Clint. And he's like, Clint, give it to me. Like, oh, so subtle.
Yeah.
Like, it's a moment, like... Most people missed it, but it is
that shows that you care about your storytelling, that you're willing to go back and try to find bits and pieces to like bring the story together, and just because it's world building, dog. That's not a big moment. That didn't make the movie, but it's world building. It shows that these movies matter to these characters, and there's consequences and relationships built back and forth. So thank you for, because it was kind of bugging me. I was like, how did he know his name? I forgot they had a little tussle in Civil War.
I obviously paid
tussle. That's
very
my
close. Tussle.
That's my.
It's a great word.
grown man word for skirmish.
Yeah. I am trying to tussle. Professor Hulk. Professor Hulk is not super well known in the Marvel world. I do think for folks who are a Hulk fan, they do know at some point Bruce and Hulk come to a place where like you have the genius of Bruce and the strength of Hulk. I don't know too much about the character, but like that is a thing. Oftentimes when Bruce's intellect matches Hulk's strength, you get a bad guy. Just keep it 100. But Professor Hulk is definitely a staple in the Marvel universe. A lot of people know about him.
So with Professor Hulk, I mean, I dug it. I'm gonna miss Hulk.
Yeah.
I think Hulk was like funny, and then just Hulk. Dog, Hulk had some. One of my favorite MCU moments is in Avengers when Captain America is giving everyone their points. Like Hawkeye, Stark, and he's like, and Hulk, and Hulk's like, huh? He's like, smash. And then Hulk just lets loose on, what is it, the Chitauri or whatever? Yeah, yeah. And like, that's one of my favorite MCU moments. So I'm kind of sad. I don't think we'll get that Hulk again.
Probably won't.
We probably won't. But I'm also kind of like, there's a dope movie in here that we're never going to get about Bruce coming to terms, being the Hulk, going back to Bruce, and like merging the two. And I'm like, it may not be a good movie. That needs to be some type of comic.
That would be a great movie.
Yeah.
That would be a great movie.
There needs to be something there, because like that whole journey, how he decided to be Professor Hulk, is probably really dope.
Yeah, I mean, it's been some of the best Marvel stories.
Yeah.
Like just the dynamic of Bruce versus Hulk, like the Jekyll and Hyde, like it is a tale as old as time, as they say.
there was a post, and I wish I remembered it to give the guy credit. But he wrote a post about he's like, Thanos, he's like, y'all understand, Thanos whooped the Hulk's ass so bad he turned him into upright citizen. he's like you understand, you gotta get your ass beat so hard that you get your life together and like, become a better person.
What am I doing with myself, man? Why am I out here just trying to fight people? Like, man, I need to go back to school, I need to get my degree.
said,
that's real.
Thanos whooped his ass into being a good person, but
and you know, like, those ass whoopings exist.
They do. It's they like, do.
You know, I ain't living.
There's right. people who like this is not the road I want to walk. For this.
I got a few more.
Yeah.
So they did a shout out to A-Force. So I'm not sure if you know about A-Force.
I've heard
A-Force
of
is the all ladies Avengers team. They did it like I don't want to say subtly. I
it think was
they
were pretty subtle. Deliberate. There's nothing subtle.
It kind of seemed a little forced.
There's absolutely no subtlety.
And some folks are probably just like, why are they so deliberate about all the ladies doing there? Part of the reason I was like with it, even though it kind of seemed forced, is like it's a shout out to A-Force. Like,
yeah.
That's kind of a big deal, and it's kind of a dope team. It had a short storytelling. But it's like a thing that Marvel fans know. It's like, oh wow, like okay, there's a little A-Force, might be a potential movie in there, who knows. Yeah,
because I'm glad you brought this up, because this scene, it has a little controversy, and there's always gonna be butthurt people. Like, dog, there's people who walked out of this movie when one of the Russos in the beginning is having the support group
mm-hmm.
with Cap. And I guess he's gay because he said he's on a date with a dude. Yeah, and there's been reports of people who like got up and walked out. I'm like, dude, like if that was my parents, I'm like, what the fuck, mom? And like, I would be pissed. Like,
I have waited my entire life.
You're going to sit
and let this gay man talk about his problems.
I'm trying to see what happens with that. Like, so that just blows my mind.
No, man. So we're leaving. No, dad.
Yeah, that blows my mind, man. I'm like, that would piss me off if I was a kid. But anyway. But there's a lot of people who are saying, oh, Marvel's turning social justice warrior and feminist, especially because Captain Marvel got a lot of good or bad. There's a lot of discussion and backlash. But I think, what's her name who plays Captain Marvel? I think she's very polarizing. I think you're either on board with her, or you think she's a little too much. And I think she's part of the reason why that movie has controversy, not just because what Marvel does with
like
that.
Her as a person?
Yeah, yeah. Because okay. She's very outspoken in her views on feminist issues and blah, blah, blah. And so, I it's the age of the internet and people got a problem. I got a problem with what you said and blah, blah, blah. So
I have some feelings about Captain Marvel as a character, as a movie character, and how Brie Larson plays her. But it has nothing to do with any of that.
Yeah, so, yeah. Interesting. I think going back, I don't know if I would have cast her. She did a good job, and she's fine. And now that she's here, I don't have a problem with her. I don't know if I would have cast her as Captain Marvel, though.
I wouldn't have.
A lot of people said they should have cast, what's her name from Game of Thrones, who was supposed to be married to Joffrey, and then was supposed to marry...
Oh, she would have been a great Captain
Yeah, Marvel. They're like, she would have been perfect.
She would have.
Yeah.
She would have. My thing is, Brie Larson is such a good actress.
She is.
She's an amazing actress. So I'll quickly talk about this. I think what they have to do is like tell Brie Larson to not act like who Captain Marvel is, but who she thinks Captain Marvel should be.
Yeah.
Because the problem is she did a too good of a job playing Captain Marvel.
Yeah.
Captain Marvel's boring. she's a boring character. Her problems are she has a Superman.
She's Marvel Superman.
She's Marvel Superman. She can do anything. She's a great leader. Everyone loves her. Her problems are the situations that she's in.
Yeah.
And that's boring.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
She can add so much character into that character.
Yeah.
Because she's such a good actress.
More than just like, I'm such a badass, look at me. It's like, yeah, that's cool, but like, we like characters because of their growth and what they become and their personal demons and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I mean, like, she just needs to let loose because she can rock the hell out of that character.
She's a great actress, man. Go watch Room. She is...
Go watch anything else she was in except for Captain Marvel. She's
pretty,
amazing.
She's pretty great. But to that A-Force scene, it's funny because when that happened, I was already caught up in a bunch of emotions. So I even teared up when I was like, oh, they got all the girls together. You know?
How many times did you cry during the Endgame?
Bro, I think I cried maybe about 5 times.
Yeah, probably the same for me.
Four to five times in this movie.
Absolutely.
We can name all
that last 30 minutes?
Yeah. I mean, it's just all these feelings.
Yes.
But I remember, and I was watching the movie with my wife, and I saw it, and that scene got me. But then I turned to her, I'm like, what do you think about that? And my wife's like, that's kind of cheesy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just because, not because they got all the girls together. And even the Russo said they they know it was kind of pandering. They don't care. They had a story and a message to tell, and they wanted to do it, so fine. But I was like,
balls.
I was like, why would all these women on this battlefield be in the same place at this very moment? And then for me, I think movies should have messages. I think they should correlate with the things we're going through in the world today, and they should be progressive in our ideas and thoughts. I'm all about that. I personally hate being taken out of the movie to be like, you get it? Message. I personally hate that, because I'm really in the story, and I really love when a movie can make me think and go back like, damn, that's kind of like this, or that's kind of like that in our world. I like that when the movie's like, okay, now you go figure it out. I hate when the movie's like, you get it? Hey!
If they had the time, they could have made it make sense. It'd be like, make it a little more natural. But they had a message, like you said, and they had the balls and the ability to do it.
But I'll also say it's their fault because they didn't develop any of these female characters in their past movies. And it's kind of like, hey, here you go. Here's all the girls. It's like,
oh my goodness, you're right.
You know, like they did. Who did they develop female character wise besides Captain Marvel?
Really, like, and if you let's be careful when we say develop, because y'all are probably thinking like, but I love Shuri, but I love Wasp. Like you do, because the actors and the actresses did a damn good job.
Yeah.
Like, they took what they got and made you fall in love with them.
Mm-hmm.
But like the story didn't really expand on like them as people. Like you don't know too much about them except for like what you've been able to see. Like there is so much story that hasn't been. Wasp is one of the most legendary Avengers.
Mm-hmm.
Like they need to make a Wasp movie, or they need to do. They need to make. I forgot her name. They need to make the Wasp character huge because she was the leader of the Avengers at one point.
Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And she was like a damn good leader.
When I saw Ant-Man and the Wasp, I'm like, okay, this should be the Wasp, and also Ant-Man's here.
That one movie, for its faults, it really played out how good the Wasp is, because she's better than Ant-Man.
She's so much better.
Yeah, that's straight from the comics.
If I was Captain America, I would slowly stop calling Ant-Man.
Like, hey, is your lady there?
Is she there? Is she busy? I mean, if you're free, but if cool. She's free.
Can you bring her?
But yeah, I mean, hey, whatever. Marvel's taking a stand on a lot of things, and Disney as a company has never been afraid to take chances and diverse when the time is right to do so. I don't want to give them all the credit, because there was a movie, there was a review this guy did about Black Panther when it came out, and he said, look, it's great, it's amazing. The revolution is not going to happen through Disney.
No.
You know, and I'm like, yeah, there's something to be said there. There is something like, it's not going to happen through Disney. The world's not going to change through Disney. Representation's not going to change through them. But that doesn't take anything away from what Black Panther did and what all these movies are doing with their diversity.
There's a whole, I mean, we obviously got to do an episode of Black Panther, because there's a whole, the Black Panther meant a lot to different people in different ways. And I think there's some false things that people took from Black Panther that they're just going to be disappointed.
Mm.
But I clearly love that movie.
Yeah,
I have just in this room alone, like four or five different Black Panther related
things. It might be one of my favorite MCUs. It's going to be a battle. I think Endgame, when it comes to it, Endgame and Guardians, the first Guardians, I think are my favorite. But Black Panther, man, it's...
Black Panther is my favorite. It's not the best one, though.
Mm-hmm.
I still think, even... I may need some distance from Infinity War and Endgame to truly appreciate it. In my mind, Winter Soldier is still number one. But it's tough for me to say that. I can defend it, but we'll talk about it later. Because I can defend why I think it's better than Civil War and the other two movies, but that's a whole nother conversation. So I'll just do one more, because we got some other stuff to talk about. Falcon, when it is Cap versus the entire Thanos army.
Go ahead. On your left.
Yes.
Dog, that's when the tears started. That's when the tears started.
Yes. Yes. So happy. On your left, if you watch Winter Soldier, when Falcon first arrives in the MCU, Cap is running around like in DC, and he's constantly saying "on your left" because he's passing Falcon, and Falcon hates it.
Yeah,
and you can tell the whole time he's like, "I'm gonna get you back. I don't know. I'm gonna get you back because I'm not a super soldier. I'm gonna get you back." And however many movies later, he gets him back.
Man.
And in what a way to get it back to.
Such a great, like, and you know what's funny? The waterworks started right before that for me, because that scene where Cap's fighting Thanos, mm-hmm. and Thanos just goes ham on him and he cracks the shield. Dog, my theater was dead silent, right? And probably a row in front of me was a little boy. And this is all I hear in my movie theater. Get up, Captain America! Get up! And I was like, "Oh Ball no!" Bitch.
I was like, "That was, I think I'm tearing up right now."
I was like, "Oh no!" I was like, "Yeah, little boy, like, dog,
he has
like
so much faith in Captain America."
And I was like, "But yo, like how we got here? That I was like, man, that is amazing that this kid got to witness this at in his childhood and grow up with these characters." And that's the difference between the MCU and the DCEU.
Yeah.
Not once was I like, "Yeah, Superman, get up, do it. Okay, Batman," because I don't care about them. Mm-hmm. Dog, we don't want Captain America to die. We don't want any of these characters to die. And like to, and that little boy hit it in a nutshell. I was like, "This is why people love this universe."
He said what we were feeling.
Yes,
get up, Captain America.
And I was like, "Oh God."
You know, not like this.
You know, there's that scene in Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood where what is his name? That Mustang's friend dies. Spoilers for Full Metal Alchemist. The guy who always loves his daughter and always,
oh yeah.
And they're burying him, and his daughter's like, "Why are they throwing that dirt on Daddy?" And everyone's just like, they're just like, "Oh God!" Like,
nobody can keep it together.
No one has the strength. And like, that's how I was, and that little boy was cheering on Captain America.
Full Metal Alchemist punches you in the gut so many God. Times. You're like, "Oh, you think it's a cartoon?
You think you grown?" But yeah, man, that whole when those portals open up and everyone's coming out, when Black Panther comes out,
I love how he was the first one to come out too.
And
I love it.
Yeah, and that, like, man, I feel like I know what Marvel's trying to say, but I feel like that's an in universe like that. I'm trying to get the words here. Like, Black Panther is the powerhouse kind of. It's like it does say a lot that he was the first one to show up. Cause it wasn't Doctor Strange, it wasn't Spider-Man, it was Black Panther, and he just looks at, he gives Captain America this look like, "Yeah, dog, I'm back.
Yeah, I'm back. We got it's you. Over.
It's over. Like, it's over, dog. Don't worry, you did good. I got this. We got this." And it's that teared me up when he walked out, and then when all the portals walked out, he got a big cheer in my audience when Black Panther showed up. I think Spider-Man got the biggest cheer though when Peter swings out of his portal. But I think that's because how he went in Infinity War.
Yeah, I think I know what kind of theater you went to. Because I was in the Magic Johnson theater.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. People were still cheering for Black Panther, yeah. Even when everyone else was out. They were like, "Yeah,
yeah,
the Black- yeah, we in here now. It's over now, man. That's Black Panther."
If you're not worried about hearing dialogue, find any Magic Johnson theater near you and go. We saw, it wasn't a Magic Johnson theater, but it might as well have been. It was one of my favorite movie going experiences. We saw White House Down.
Yes. In Chinatown.
In Chinatown in D.C. It was one of the greatest movie experiences of my life. So do yourself a favor. Find a Magic Johnson theater near you and go now.
That's what they were made for.
Yeah.
And I appreciate it took a movie like Avengers Endgame, because everything was sold out. There was a couple white people there, and like, they got a taste of a Magic Johnson theater, and they were not ready. But it was something like Avengers and movies all together. The movie? They were just like, "Oh, I can clap. I can scream. It's accepted here. Great."
Sharon, oh man, they're really into this Black Panther guy.
They're like, "Okay, I like him too, but not this much. But you guys are still clapping for him?"
But yeah, man, that and then, I mean, I don't know if this is next on your list, but that whole last hour. It's probably 45 minutes. That is movie magic. That is why movies exist. That is why Hollywood exists. And I'm going to put the flag in the sand. I don't think we'll ever get a bigger thing than Endgame. I don't think there will be anything. And when I mean bigger, I just mean the whole, like, how this happened. How all these characters, this universe.
I mean, we're talking over 50 characters.
Different properties. I don't think we'll ever see anything like that ever again.
It's kind of sad, but I think you're right.
You know, and I just don't think it's possible. Unless
we get this Super Smash Brothers movie.
But even then. Now you got me. I'm like, damn, dog. It's Super Smash Brothers run deep now.
running with Super Mario?
Man, but hey. But I just don't think it's going to happen. And a friend of ours, we argued, and he really downplayed this movie. He's like, oh, they're going to win. And like, we knew they're going to win. I'm like, dog, that's not the point. Like, of course we knew they're going to win. There's no way Black Panther makes $1 billion and that's his last movie. Mm-hmm. You know?
It's comic books.
It's comic books. And it's not about the deaths. It's about how the characters deal with it. Mm-hmm. And their world. And I think we kind of skipped over it. The first hour of this movie, people say it's slow. I loved it. I loved everything. Like the whole, like, dealing with this failure. How they ran up on Thanos. The Thanos chilling memes in the Avenger show are like, I love the internet. They're so funny.
So I want to say my favorite scene, because it's in there. And you've talked about a few of your favorite scenes. But my favorite scene is Cap. And I think I mentioned this already. Cap standing there, tightening up the shield over the wound, and walking up to Thanos and all of Thanos' armies is directly from the Infinity Gauntlet.
Really?
Comic. Yeah. Instead of like his army, it's just Thanos. Mm-hmm. And it's Thanos versus Cap. And Thanos had just killed everybody. Like, everyone was dead. He killed Hulk. He killed Iron Man. It was Captain America was the last person there. And Cap's like,
well,
if one of us stands up, then you haven't won.
Yeah.
And starts walking towards him. And that's exact scene. They play it out, but even crazier, they did it in an even more beautiful way.
Yeah.
In the movie than in the comic book. And I was like, this is it. This is why I'm so invested in this stuff.
Yeah.
Like, you rewarded, like, I could have not pictured seeing this in a way when I first read the Infinity Gauntlet.
And I think Kevin Feige has done a great job with rewarding comic book fans, but not isolating the general public.
Yeah.
And I think that's a hard line to cross, because
comic book fans are crazy.
Yeah. And it's like, there's a lot of book purists out there for anything, but just to like, not isolate your audience, but like, hey, comic book nerds, if you read this, remember this. And still, I hate when people are like, well, if you read the book, well, I'm not reading the comic or the book. Mm-hmm. I'm watching the movie, so it should all be explained in the movie. And Marvel has never like led us astray with their storytelling or their Easter eggs. Easter eggs should be that. They should be Easter eggs. You shouldn't have to read this side story or play the video game to get something in the book or movie. Or you know what I'm trying to say.
I feel you. So there's three quick things that I want to talk about, and we're going to wrap up. First, I just want to give a big shout out to Thanos. Thanos is, like, this movie did not hurt him being one of the best characters of all time. I got a quote. This is a quote from one of my frat brothers, Otis. He said, bruh, if there was a restaurant with fortune cookies with only Thanos quotes, he'd go. And I was like, yep, I would go too. Like, the man's one-liners, even in this movie too, like, when Scarlet Witch is like, you took everything from me. And he was like, I don't even know you. But you know what? I probably did.
I probably did. But, you know, that's what I do.
That's what, like the dude, I'm so excited to see what the next 10 years holds for villains. Because, like, he just created a foundation of, like, everything you want from a villain you got from Thanos. He was, like, scary. He was charismatic.
Mm-hmm.
He was emotionally grounded and sinister at the same time.
Yeah.
And like, when he showed emotion, it was scary.
Yeah.
For everyone involved.
He's the kind of character even subconsciously, you're like, man, I hope he doesn't get emotional, because that means we're fucked.
Yeah.
You know?
When he was like, you know what, I'm done with y'all, he brought his entire army.
But I do think, like, they didn't drop the ball with Thanos, but like I guess I was wanting more Thanos.
You'll always want more
Thanos. You know, in this, and I think his turn when he realized that he was gonna erase everything, I feel like that should have been a little bit more scarier than it was. Yeah. But I do like he's like a universe that I thought would be grateful, so ungrateful. It is, you know, but it shows the arrogance of him that he's just gonna start everything over. But like I love to see who's his boys, his like horsemen or whatever.
The Dark Order or something like that.
I love Ebony Maw. I didn't know anything about Ebony Maw until Infinity War, and when he died, I was like, oh, I kinda like that guy. So that to see him back, I really dug that.
Bro, you need to read the comics.
Is
if
he,
you like him,
yeah.
Then granted, he's a little bit more cooler in the. No, he's pretty cool in the comic. You should read the comic.
Yeah, he seems like a pretty cool character.
So the question that I have for you before we wrap it up is, if you could have done anything differently for Avengers Endgame, what would you have done? And I will start if it's
okay. Yeah, because that's yeah.
There's only really two things I would have done differently. Instead of Cap getting the hammer, I would have given the hammer to someone who has actually had the powers of Thor already. So
like a Bill, what's that guy, Bill Ray?
I would have had Better Ray Bill come into this movie.
Can you, what is he?
Better Ray Bill is an alien.
Okay.
There's a reason that most of the folks in our generation know Better Ray Bill is because he was Thor in like around the time where we were growing up.
Okay.
Thor had like, wasn't worthy anymore. Better Ray Bill was worthy, and then he got his own. Like Stormbreaker is Better Ray Bill's actual weapon. It's not Thor's weapon.
Mm, okay.
And so like you know him because he blew up in the early 90s.
Yeah.
And he's just like a horse face, goat face, badass. Yeah. He's so in the battle world where Hulk was battling folks, Better Ray Bill was the original champion of it.
Yeah, because in the Planet Hulk cartoon movie, that's who Hulk fights.
Yeah, because he was the champion.
Yeah, yeah.
So I would have had Better Ray Bill come out just because like the fan in me wants to see Better Ray Bill.
And in Ragnarok,
There's a statue of him
in Ragnarok.
Now, if you want to go with the let's not create new characters for Endgame because there was 59 characters already, then I would have had Jane Foster get the hammer and be Thor. Because in the comic books, Jane Foster was Thor for a bit.
Yeah.
And it was really good. Like, I don't know if you've ever read any of y'all have read the Thor comic books, female Thor. It's pretty entertaining. I enjoyed a couple of the series. So if Natalie Portman doesn't hate Marvel anymore, it would have just been dope to see her get the hammer. All of a sudden her hair is blonde. Next thing you know, she's Thor. That would have been dope.
Shout out to Natalie Portman for getting a check for just waking up.
Do you think that was that in the movie, or did they just cut? She actually filmed it.
So the word on the street is that was a body double, and they grafted her face onto the body.
Yeah, because she said she's done.
Yeah,
I'm like, yo, come back.
Why would you be done,
bro? I know the first two weren't that good.
Yeah, but you like Thor is hot in the streets right now, and he's still not over. And I think they're leaving in for her because Thor is still clearly not over.
Nah, he's not over.
So I think they're like leaving it open. But yeah, my bad. I didn't want to interrupt.
And then the second thing I would have done was introduce Soul World. Well, not introduce, because they kind of explain Soul World. So Soul World, the Soul Gem is one of the big things that the Soul Gem does is, besides like connect people to the soul, is that there is a world inside the gem called the Soul World. That's where like Adam Warlock lives for a long time. It's where I believe where Thanos wakes up and sees young Gamora. I think he's in Soul World, but I'm not 100% sure. Instead of all the characters coming back from a snap, I would have had them all had been in the Soul World and escaped the Soul World. Because Soul World's pretty big deal in Marvel history, so I would have done that.
Those are the only two things that would have been different. The Soul World, that's when Thanos sees young Gamora and she's like, what did it cost?
I think so.
Everything.
I think that's Soul World. I think that's what they were trying to do with Soul World, but I'm not 100% sure.
Okay. I'm with it. You have some very comic book fan nerd alterations, and I can dig them. Billy Ray Bill. That would have been cool. I don't think there's, like you said, there's the time to do it. But man, no. Cap grabbing that sword, that
I mean, hammer. It wasn't bad. Oh, selfie. Hey. All
right. It's a big cheer moment. Like some type of flashback or something, and seeing Hulk deal with and become Professor Hulk.
That would have been nice, yeah.
You know, just seeing how he got there. Dude, I really dug the first hour of this movie, so I don't know if it could have been a little mini series, a little because I was really into The Leftovers, that has a similar concept, and where a part of the population just disappears and there's no reason why, and it's with that, how would that change the world? How would we deal with that as a society? What would matter to us? Would insurance change? Would technical, what is being alive and death change? I think all that stuff is very interesting. I mean, man, this it's not a perfect movie, but it's damn near, it's really enjoyable. I think doing a little bit more character study on how they're dealing with their failures in the beginning, after the snapture. The snapture. I forgot who coined that. I didn't make that up, but someone coined that, and it's pretty dope, and I'm sticking with it. I'm not really satisfied with how they ended Black Widow.
Me neither.
And her being the sacrifice. I
think we're getting her back, though.
Yeah, I think we're getting her back, too, but I don't know. I kind of would have wanted to see her on that battlefield, and I don't know how else they could have handled that Soul Stone situation. It's fine, but like going back, I don't know how I would have changed it, but I don't know if I would have made the whole Natasha or Hawkeye sacrifice one of themselves, because I like Hawkeye's story. I like how he lost everything, so, and they kind of didn't even really dwell on it in the Hawkeye movie, not even a movie, maybe a comic. His turn seemed so logical. Like, he lost everything. Good people disappeared, and y'all evil mugs got to stay. No, it ain't going out like that. I'm killing all y'all. Yep. And I'm like, yo, like, just a hell-bent Hawkeye killing cartel leaders, Yakuza. That sounds really dope.
Like, we saw 2 minutes of that, and it was fire.
But, like, that, like, just a man on fire movie starring Hawkeye. Sounds pretty cool.
It looks pretty good.
You know, I think, man, I really like Cap getting the hammer. I don't think I changed that. I don't know, man. I don't think there's a lot I would change, just because I think the story they were trying to tell, and they did, worked out. I think I get a little bit more Thanos, and I think I'd get more emotion out of Thanos when he realizes that he lost, and that he, because his whole thing is like, he's like, I'm doing y'all a favor. And like, I know it seems harsh, but I'm doing y'all a favor. So him, like,
being, he took more, defeat really well for someone who doesn't lose like that.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, man, I don't think and I know as soon as we finish recording, I'm like, oh, this. But I think I'm just so, this movie for me was such a good, like, it was such a good meal.
Yeah.
I was just full and content and just, you know, and I just walked out that theater not wanting anything else. You know, there was no end credit scene. That was fine with me. I was just so content with the way they ended this thing that they had to juggle. Could they done better things better along the way? Yeah, like, looking back, there's stories they could have avoided telling or maybe told better, but it just all wrapped together so good for me. And then, quick little note, so the I am Iron Man snap.
Yeah.
Which, the Iron Man snap, you know that wasn't planned.
No, what do you mean?
Yeah, so you would think, right? I am Iron Man. You'd think they planned it from the get-go. So they wanted Tony to say something. Mm-hmm. Nothing was really working, so they're like, all right, well, he's just not going to say anything. He's just going to snap. And apparently, if I'm getting the story right, when they were editing, the editor was like, why not he just say, I am Iron Man? And the Russos were like, oh shit, get Robert Downey Jr. And they did it like with like a day. They did that scene in a day. They're like, that's a great idea. And so it worked out and they did that scene in one day. So that wasn't even going to be in the movie.
That was a perfect way to end it though.
Right. And it's just funny. Like we talk about like it being organic. Like sometimes those things just have to happen. It's great to like plan things out, but sometimes you got to let things happen and let characters and story develop.
That guy definitely got some money after that.
Yeah. What a great way to end that character though, man.
Yeah. Just the way it started. Yeah. It's beautiful. So let's wrap up. We're at time. Literally, we're at time. So going back to our kids. So there's Marvel movies aren't going to end. There's going to be a new phase that comes up. And this next phase is going to be kind of pivotal in our kids' lives because they'll actually be old enough to retain some of the things that are going to come out. So in the next two phases in Marvel, what would you want to see come out? What characters would you want to see develop? Not just for you, but to keep in mind for Kosi.
Yeah.
And for your nephew, Ian. Like, what things would you want to see, characters, stuff like that?
I would love to see, I don't know if we could get it, Miles get into this universe. I know she's not really beloved in the comic book world like Miles, but I would really love to see Ironheart kind of get her way in here.
Talk about polarizing.
Yeah, like, and I don't know much about her. All I know is that you love her or hate her. It's not like a Miles. Like, people love Miles, but Ironheart, people love her or hate her. But I think for, like, young girls, young black girls, seeing someone like that, I think Shuri, they could set her up to be very important in this universe. I would love to see something where, like, her and Reed Richards are like developing technology, things like that. I don't know a lot of Marvel deep cuts because like I was a DC person growing up.
Yeah.
So when it comes to deep cut people, I mean, I don't know. At this point, I'm kind of just waiting to see what happens. I think they need to do their female characters some justice in this next and really develop some and have some dope movies beyond like Black Widow. But at this point, man, I'm riding on such good faith. I think they know what they're doing, the ball's in their court, and they're gonna do right by all their new fans because they've created new fans and they know they've created new groups of fans and people, demographics that like these movies. I think we're gonna get, like you said, the A-Force.
Yeah.
I think we're gonna get that. I think we're gonna see Miss Marvel eventually.
Kamala Khan.
I think that's gonna happen.
Yeah.
I don't think we're gonna get a Marvel Rising.
What's that?
It's this, I don't know if it's new, but it's Squirrel Girl.
We're not getting Squirrel Girl.
It's Spider Gwen.
Oh yeah. We're not getting any of those. That's a new cartoon that's out.
Okay. And then the Hispanic girl she's not Captain
America Chavez.
Yeah, America. Yeah. But maybe we'll get a Disney Plus movie or I mean apparently I keep seeing Squirrel Girl and I don't know why the life of me she keeps appearing in my life.
Squirrel Girl is because she's unbeatable. Squirrel Girl took down Thanos in like a page. She's unstoppable. The powers of a squirrel.
But I think just and I'm gonna wrap up here, but I think just the way movies and TV are going, I think we're gonna get a lot more female protagonists out of the MCU. I think we might get some like some gay and trans characters and superhero. I know a lot of people are like, no, not in my mind. You know, I'm not here to talk about that right now. I'm just saying that's what I think we're gonna get.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, I feel like, yo, you can feel how you feel, but like these groups of people exist and to like act like they don't is kind of like delusional.
Yeah, I would just throw out there for those folks who don't want to see a gay or trans superhero, just to like be a little bit of a realist for you, if we're doing the numbers, if you're trying to like see this in real life, there's already a gay superhero. All them folks on screen,
one of them
already gay.
one of them statistically,
they may not have be out, but one of them are gay. And I'm not talking about the actors, I'm talking about the straight up character.
Yeah,
one of them is not straight. So, like, get it together. We just talking numbers here. Get it together.
And Fantastic Four. I'm so ready to see that done right, finally.
Our lists are pretty similar. So the first three characters that I want to see are all ladies. Kamala Khan, Miss Marvel. It's a great comic book. I think every time we talked about a comic book, I mentioned,
like, you put me on it. It's a nice, fun book.
It's a great book. Like, it doesn't take too much mental dexterity to read. Like, it's fun. It's enjoyable. She is a great character. I really think that teenagers can relate to her well. Mm-hmm. And yes, she is a Muslim character, and, like, dope. Because, again, if you do the numbers, there's probably already one we just ain't know
yet.
Kamala Khan's awesome. I can't wait to see her. She-Hulk is one of the most vital members of Avengers, and she has yet to be represented in this because there's Hulk. I think with this new phase, we can maybe get She-Hulk. I'm not saying she should get her own movie. I actually don't think the character's strong enough to get her own movie, but she should definitely be a person in, like, the next team up movie.
Oh, the fan art.
The fan art. Horrible. The next character that I'm excited for is Monica Rambeau. She is Spectrum. She was one of the original Captain Marvels. Her character was introduced in the Captain Marvel movie. If you love the black characters in Marvel like I do, then you already know who Spectrum is. She's like the Rey analog for Marvel. She's like light, power, and stuff like that. I'm just excited because I think she will be introduced and done really well in the Marvel universe. And then everything else is just, like, things that I want to see. So I want to see Storm and T'Challa get married or get together. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the last thing I want to see. I can die a good man if I see Storm and T'Challa get together. And that's the last thing I need.
Yeah.
That is it. I would have seen everything I want to see in movies.
Definitely powerful. Like they're the Obamas of the MCU.
They are the Obamas of the MCU. Now, these are things I would like to see. I would like to see Morph and Mr. Sinister represented. Morph mostly because of the cartoon.
Morph!
Our history with Morph in the cartoons. And Mr. Sinister is just a creepy dude.
Yeah.
And, like, I'd love to see him represented in the movies. I'm with you. I want to see a good Fantastic Four movie. Even though we've seen two of them in The Incredibles. Mm-hmm. Like, we've seen good Fantastic Four movies. But I'd like to see, like, they're the first family of Marvel. They deserve to have a good movie. I'd like to see it. And last but not least, I want my son to know about Doctor Doom. Like,
done right.
When I think about legacy, like, Doctor Doom is one of the greatest villains of all time. He's inspired some of the best villains that we have.
Yeah.
And he has not done in an epic nature that he deserves to be.
No. Doctor Doom could have done Infinity War and Endgame by himself. He could have figured that out. He could have beat Thanos. Him.
Like, honestly, like, it's and people are like, why is Doctor Doom such a big deal? Imagine Batman with Doctor Strange powers and, like, just, like, the sheer will and determination to have power because he is cocky enough to think that he can rule the universe. And when he's done it, he's been great at it.
Yeah.
Like, Doctor Doom is such a great character. I have actually written a short story about Doctor Doom because I've been so motivated to get some type of story on. Like, yes.
Can you share it?
I will share it.
All right.
Yeah, it's not done yet.
Okay.
I can show it to you. Like, I want my son to know about Doctor Doom. I want him to know how badass of a character he is. And I want him to see it done right.
Yeah. I think to piggyback on something you said real quick, I'm eager to see how Kevin Feige brings in the X-Men and how they exist in this world where we already kind of have metahumans, and why mutants are going to be persecuted and discriminated against. That always seemed weird to me. It's like, y'all live in a world where Spider-Man and the Hulk exist, and I guess technically they're not mutants, but what's the difference between them and the X-Men? And why are the X-Men?
In the comics or, like...
Yeah, in the comics.
It's coming up?
No, in the comics, that always I was like, why do people hate the X-Men but everyone loves Spider-Man? Yeah. And I want to see how they, in a movie world, how they, whatever they're going to do to bring the X-Men in here, why is the world going to be scared of mutants? I'm interested to see how they do
you
that.
You got to go through the persecution part.
Yeah, right? You got to.
Because it's an important part of it.
Introduce this world, these movies to our kids. One thing I am going to do, I am not going to show Kosi these movies in chronological order, because I think it does a disservice to all the movies. I'm going to show her the way they came out, because I feel like if you watch them in chronological order, there's things that like lose meaning and Easter eggs that, you know what I'm saying? Mm. Like there's things about Captain America First Avenger that like are like very like, oh, cool. But you have to watch Iron Man first. You have to watch Incredible Hulk first. Otherwise, it's not going to have any weight. So, and that's just me personally. I don't think these movies should be watched for the first time in chronological order. I think you should watch them the way they came out, the way they were intended to be seen. And then if you want to go back and watch them in order, do it like that.
Yeah, I agree 100%. Mm-hmm. I'm curious. I want to see how Ian does it. Because he's already seen Black Panther like 5 times at one year of age. So I'm going to want him to be like, so where did Bucky come from? And like,
yeah.
Okay, well, these are the movies he came from. What you going to do? Mm. And so maybe he'll go to Winter Soldier. And then he's like, how did this happen? And then he'll want to go here and there. Like, I want to see how he does it.
Gotcha.
He's a completionist, I believe. Yeah. So
he
may listen. Yeah.
All the Michael Bay Transformers movies. But anyway.
So thanks for listening, everyone. Thanks for tuning in to the Pop Cult. We have a new episode every month. You can find us on all social media at Pop Cult Parent. POPCULTPARENT. Pop Cult Parent. You can email us at popcultparent@gmail.com. Don't forget to rate us, review us, and subscribe. Are we going to talk about what we're doing next month? Maybe not.
What do you got?
there are some choices. I love like talking about it because like we want to tease y'all, but there's like 3 things in the air right now.
So many things going on right now that we need to like...
We need to acknowledge.
Yeah.
One of them may be Pokemon related.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Yeah.
We will see. And we may have a special guest. We will see.
Ooh.
All right. That's all it, everybody.
Pop culture. Assemble.
Don't forget to join the Pop Cult, everyone.
Peace.